Baker Donelson is one of the nation's 50 largest law firms with over 650 attorneys in 19 offices. Among other practices, we have a team of experienced attorneys focusing on serving the legal needs of educational institutions across a broad spectrum of legal matters, including intellectual property and licensing, construction and public finance, labor and employment, privacy, information security, and data breaches, and other unique issues affecting colleges like student discipline, sexual misconduct, and intercollegiate athletics. This year, every month, we're hosting a complimentary webinar addressing timely topics across the spectrum of legal matters. Next month's higher ed webinar will focus on privacy and security. This topic has been of interest to athletic and legal departments based on recent litigation involving the intersection of Title IX, FERPA student privacy regulations, and HIPAA regulations that protect the privacy of medical records. So if you're already on the list to receive emails from Baker Donelson, please look for our webinar announcements in the coming months. And if someone forwarded this invitation to you, feel free to email Dan to be added to our list for future webinars. One of Baker Donelson's areas of focus for higher ed clients is athletics, where we represent a substantial number of institutions dealing with a variety of legal issues. For example, we assist universities with legal aspects of their athletic strategic planning initiatives. We lead external due diligence projects for university athletic departments, and we develop risk management and litigation avoidance strategies. We also work with universities and their athletic departments on construction and facilities issues. And we work hand in hand with institutions on Title IX audits and compliance reviews to improve their compliance, or we can serve as independent investigative counsel in regards to athletics and misconduct matters. And when universities do face Title IX complaints, we defend them against litigation and Office for Civil Rights, or OCR, investigations. Today's speaker, Dan Cohen, will discuss Title IX athletics compliance in the age of full cost of attendance scholarships and perpetual budgetary pressures. Dan is the chair at Baker Donelson's higher ed education team. He's been working with universities on Title IX matters for almost 20 years, counting his time working on campus, where he was involved with two OCR investigations and one federal Title IX lawsuit. Since then, Dan has represented universities across the country, from Southern Florida to the state of Washington, in Title IX matters. Dan is appointed as a Special Assistant Attorney General by two states to represent certain public institutions in Title IX matters. He has testified in Washington, D.C. regarding Title IX best practices and been published and quoted frequently in the media regarding Title IX and other legal issues facing college athletics. He is a graduate of Duke University and Vanderbilt University School of Law. And with that, I'll turn it over to Dan.
Thank you. I'm glad that you could. Set it up with a dashboard where you can ask questions. So please feel free over the course of the program to type up your questions, send them in, and I'll try to address them as they come in. Or, of course, you can contact me afterwards to discuss offline. As part of this presentation, I'm going to assume that you have at least a basic understanding of Title IX, but I do want to spend a few minutes giving you the legal foundation for the discussion first, because that's what's often missing in the media soundbite types of Title IX coverage that we hear most often these days. So we'll start with a quick overview of Title IX's athletic provisions, then we'll move into a discussion of the three-prong test. We'll look at actual compliance statistics and trends, as well as litigation trends, so you know where your greatest risks are for your school. We'll have a detailed discussion of legal and practical strategies under the three-prong test that you may be able to implement on your campus to improve your compliance. And then we'll talk about Title IX's scholarship provisions as well to give you a better feel for what is and is not required under the law. Again, we'll look at actual compliance statistics and have a detailed discussion of what this means to you as you're considering how to implement full cost of attendance on your campus and how to balance compliance with the economic realities that your school is facing. So just very briefly, as part of the overview, there are 13 distinct program areas as part of Title IX, which are generally put into three categories. The first two categories, participation opportunities and scholarships, are most well known. They both have objective components, and you're required to report your numbers on the EADA report each year. Because of that public exposure, these are the areas where you also have the most external and litigation exposure, or exposure to investigations by the Federal Office for Civil Rights. The other 11 areas pertain to the equitable provision of resources. things like equipment and supplies, scheduling of games and practice times, and the other things that hopefully you're already familiar with as you see on the screen here. For right now, the takeaway is that each of these 13 areas is distinct, and a school is required to comply with each area. So before we move into a more detailed discussion, let's talk just a little bit about the process. There are two types of legal proceedings in regard to Title IX athletics issues or alleged violations. First, there's litigation, and second, there are OCR investigations. So in regard to litigation, it only takes one aggrieved student or coach or other person affiliated with your school to file litigation against you. But generally speaking, these are people who have allegedly been hurt or injured by something that your program has done wrong. On the other hand, complete outsiders can initiate OCR investigations against you, and then OCR is statutorily required to investigate. OCR investigations are particularly easy for Title IX activists to initiate. A few years ago, some Title IX activists from the state of Washington decided to go after the entire South Carolina Department of Education. Closer to you, last April, 9 schools in the Pennsylvania State Athletic Conference were simultaneously targeted with Title IX complaints all at once by Title IX activists. I'm aware of a male dentist in Wichita who is active in efforts to protect swimming programs. The point is that there's no geographic restriction. They don't need to have any ties to your campus, yet they can file OCR complaints against you based on what your EADA report might reflect or other information that's publicly available on the internet. And probably the most scary example of this came last January when 121 California colleges were simultaneously hit with Title IX complaints. We'll come back to talk about that issue later, but I want you to understand just how easy this is for Title IX activists to decide, hey, this is the week I'll file complaints against all SEC schools or all MAC schools or all schools in the state of Tennessee or Massachusetts or Georgia. But now let's actually jump into what it all, how you comply, what it all means. So first let's talk about the three-prong test and particularly participation opportunities. But first, the three-prong test. I assume that you know about it, but schools have three alternative ways to demonstrate that they are providing equitable participation opportunities in athletics. Prong one is commonly referred to as proportionality. A school complies with prong one if it provides athletic participation opportunities for men and women in a ratio that is substantially proportionate to their respective enrollments. So for example, if a school has 51% of its women, 51% women in its student body, then approximately 51% of its athletic opportunities must be given to women. Prong two involves program expansion. The school can comply by demonstrating a history and continuing practice of expanding its athletic offerings in a way that is demonstrably responsive to the developing athletic interests and abilities of its underrepresented students, which usually are female students. And then under prong three, a school complies with Title IX if it demonstrates that the interests and abilities of members of the underrepresented gender are fully and effectively accommodated by the present athletic program. These are alternatives. You can comply under any prong, but of course there are specific requirements under each prong, and there are distinct benefits to following certain compliance methods, which we'll talk about. Prong one is the most well-known. It's what you hear about in the media. Why? Because it's easy. It's easy to understand the math, and your proportionality numbers are publicly reported on your Equity in Athletics Disclosure Act reports every year. I know that a lot of athletic administrators hate the EADA reports. They are a burden to fill out. They are, in a lot of ways, illogical. The EADA report would have you believe that male practice players are actually female student athletes. So a lot of times athletic administrators complete the EADA report and then they just want to wash their hands of it. But what I want you to understand right now is that people do look at those reports. It's the first place that plaintiff's attorneys look if they're thinking about suing your school. It's a tool that OCR utilizes. It's a tool that, outside of plaintiff's attorneys, just Title IX activists, it's a tool that they use. So obviously there are external benefits if you comply with prong one. And beyond simply the compliance with prong one, OCR or plaintiffs may assume that if you have problems under prong one, maybe this school is not proactive. Maybe the school has Title IX problems elsewhere. And conversely, because of the prominence in the media, in particular, of prong one, compliance with prong one tends to decrease your chances of being sued or investigated, even if you have compliance problems in other areas. So from a risk management standpoint, if you're close to prong one, go ahead and get there. So let's see if our polling slides are working. Okay, they're not. So I wanted to try to interact with you here by asking a polling slide to see what you think the national compliance trends are here. How many schools do you think are within 2% of proportionality? Well, I'll go ahead and show you the answer since you can't actually use your voting buttons quite yet, and I apologize for the technical difficulties. We'll see if we can get that ironed out before we have more polling questions coming up later in the program. These are your latest self-reported, publicly available data. These are straight from your EADA reports. So let's take a look at what we have here. During the 2013-2014 school year, according to your very own EADA reports, only 12.6% of all NCAA schools self-reported that they were within 2% of proportionality. And I see that a question came in, what is meant by substantial proportionality? Well, this 2% is kind of a rule of thumb. And I know that the rule of thumb has changed through the years. It is not a specific black and white answer. But we have a case involving Quinnipiac University a couple of years ago where the judge held that a 2.2% prong one gap was not close enough to comply. In that particular case, 25 student athletes could fit within that 2.2% prong one gap. And the case itself dealt with the potential elimination of a women's volleyball team. And because a women's volleyball team clearly would be viable with fewer than 25 roster spots, then a full volleyball team could fit within that 2.2% prong one compliance gap, and the school was not in compliance with prong one despite it having a gap that small. Legally speaking, the test for prong one compliance is a mouthful. Lawyers came up with it, so that's what we do. The test is that you will comply with prong one if no viable team would fit within your prong one gap. What exactly that means? Well, frankly, it's a prong three test, and we'll turn to prong three in a few minutes. But you're not going to be required to add a rowing program under, you know, the 2.2% Quinnipiac gap because the average NCAA Division I roster size for rowing is up in the 60s. They would not fit within the 25 student gap. But to stay on this slide for just a moment to try to understand what I'm trying to depict here, it's really just the stoplight colors. There are a number of schools that are obviously within range of proportionality, within range of that 2% gap. So that's my yellow. If you're between 5% and 2%, whether it's on the minus side, all of these slides are depicted from the female student athlete standpoint. So women are underrepresented towards the top, and men are the underrepresented gender towards the bottom where we have the pluses. I think the most, other than the fact that only, despite all the media attention, only 12.6% of all NCAA institutions are within 2% of proportionality, I think the most astounding fact here, looking at your own EADA reports, is that women are the underrepresented gender by more than 5% at 70.1% of all NCAA institutions. And to take that one step further, 54% of all NCAA institutions have a prong one compliance gap that's 10% or worse. So this is another depiction of it. And this is not intended to show whether men or women are the underrepresented gender. This is just kind of the stoplight theory. How many schools are green, how many are in the yellow zone, and how many schools are probably outside of the realm of being able to argue that they comply with prong one because their prong one gap is more than 5%. So, what are most of you doing to comply with providing equitable participation opportunities? You are, or you should be, complying with either prong two or prong three. Both of these are viable alternatives. You can comply under any prong. But both prong two and prong three require the monitoring of student interest. That's where I found that many schools have problems. They think they comply, but they haven't actually, or they haven't adequately, been monitoring student interest. OCR will not be satisfied, especially under prong three, unless there's active monitoring. So staying on prong two for a moment, it's actually much more difficult to comply with prong two than people realize. First, it requires a history and continuing practice. So simply adding a new team now, if you haven't added a team in 10 years, that's probably not going to be sufficient to demonstrate that you have both the history and the continuing practice of program expansion. And then furthermore, whatever you add must be demonstrably responsive to your female students' athletic interests, assuming, of course, that you're one of the many schools where women are the underrepresented gender. So what does it mean to be demonstrably responsive? Well, if you decide that you want to add a rowing program simply because you want to add 60 bodies, but you have no facts to demonstrate that your students are interested in rowing, you may not actually comply with prong two even if you add that rowing program if you cannot demonstrate that it's responsive to your students' athletic interests. And then, of course, one more factor having to do with prong two is that it can only protect you temporarily, only while that continuing practice is in place. So most schools comply or attempt to comply with prong three. The test here is that you will comply with prong three unless there is sufficient interest to sustain a team, a new team, there's sufficient ability to sustain a new team, and there is a likelihood of competition in your normal competitive region. The key under this test really is determining the athletic interests of your current and admitted female students. Even though the test does have an ability aspect to it, I can tell you OCR largely ignores that today. There's a build it and they will come type mentality with OCR. If your students demonstrate that they are interested in a new sport that you're not currently offering, OCR will assume you can recruit students with sufficient ability to sustain the team. So the likelihood of competition in your normal competitive region, that is an important and viable part of the test. If you are located in Texas, you are not going to be required to add a skiing team. You will not have a likelihood of competition. But when it comes to ability, that's really where, I'm sorry, when it comes to interest, that's really where the rub is. So OCR came out with an 8-factor test to help schools measure students' athletic interests. And you can read this, but the takeaway is really that OCR designed this to cast a wide net. Cast a wide net to find out whether your students are interested in additional sports that the school doesn't currently offer. OCR recommends that you have policies in place to monitor these different indicia of interest on an ongoing basis and at least annually. If you have questions about these particulars under prong three, feel free to either email in a question here or contact me offline and I'd be happy to discuss with you. But the point is that if you're not in compliance with prong one or prong two, this is the law for prong three. This is what schools are required to do. As through the economic downturn, we've seen more and more schools move towards prong three. It is viable. And the good news is that this is something that your schools can do. They can achieve compliance with prong three. Honestly, smaller schools often have an easier time establishing prong three compliance because there are fewer students to measure their interests, and also it's less likely that they'll be able to fill out a full roster. There's an economic benefit to prong three. If you comply, you don't have to add any sports. It's the cheapest way to comply. But the key really under prong three is taking proper steps to proactively measure your students' interests and then to be able to show factually that you're currently meeting your students' athletic interests. You need to be able to document your compliance and demonstrate that you properly cast that wide net that OCR is looking for. A few more kind of practice tips here. I recommend that you do so incrementally. You don't want to generate bad data that you could have avoided. So in litigation, there's a saying, particularly at trial, that you don't want to ask a question that you don't already know the answer to. If you are a large school with few current athletic offerings, you probably don't want to go ahead and administer a student athletic interest survey that might return that your students are interested in four or five new sports that you don't offer. You might want to take incremental steps to determine whether there is unmet interest on your campus. And if you think there is, you might want to try a prong two strategy instead. And that's something that we work with schools on regularly. Another point is involve your general counsel. So your steps to comply with Title IX, which after all is federal law, make sure that your steps are protected legally by the attorney-client privilege. And of course, you also want to make sure that your university administration is involved. I think university administrations are much more involved in Title IX issues since 2011 with all the sexual misconduct cases going around the country. But it's very important that for them to understand that NCAA compliance, Title IX athletics compliance is not something that is simply an athletics problem. they must under your university administration must understand that a Title IX violation is an institutional liability. And from your standpoint, it also might help them understand they might have to help fund any changes that may be required. And also there's a philosophical point. What happens if your Prom 3 efforts return information that your female students are, number one, are underrepresented, but number two, are interested in a new sport? Well, you might need to add a new sport. Not only is that a matter of federal law, but frankly, that's the right thing to do. That's most consistent with the spirit of Title IX to expand athletic opportunities for the underrepresented gender. So those are some of the overarching legal and strategic points, but ultimately there's a lot of flexibility under Title IX. So you have the opportunity to pick your prom. You can make it work on your campus because schools have a lot of flexibility under the law to run their athletic departments as they see fit. So we have here, sorry, I went one too far. So a couple of kind of practice tips here. If you are not compliant with prong three, this is something that folks don't often realize. If you're not if you are compliant with prong three, you do not need to roster manage towards prong one. Now, maybe you'd want to. There is that optical benefit of being in compliance with single digits. I think that optically, you face less risk if you're at minus 8 instead of minus 12. But legally speaking, whether you're minus 8 or you're minus 4, either way, you're probably not in compliance with prong 1. So under this formulation, if you're a prong 3 school, it's okay to add men's teams. It's okay to use athletics to drive tuition, to meet the athletic interests well beyond the narrow formulation that we often hear about in the media. So if you're a smaller private mid-major with finite resources that's been trying to comply with prong one, but you have a strong likelihood of complying with prong three, it makes a lot of sense to at least consider whether prong three might work. If so, you could take off the prong one handcuffs and allow your football roster to expand from, say, 90 to 100 students with walk-ons, who in turn would generate something like $200,000 to $400,000 of new tuition revenue for your school. You know, if you're in that position, it doesn't really matter if you drift from, let's say, minus 4 to minus 8, because you're not going to be compliant with prong 1 under a minus 4 formulation anyway. Another strategy that I've seen schools utilize, this happens more at the Division II level than it does at the Division I level. It happens more with private schools than it happens with public schools. But lacrosse, we've seen a proliferation of lacrosse programs, particularly at the D2 level. Why? Because if you add men's and women's lacrosse, you can probably add 80 new student athletes to your university that could generate $1.5 million, $3 million in new tuition, maybe more in the way of additional costs if we're assuming that they're all paying full tuition. Lacrosse players tend to come from more affluent backgrounds, and so they might be more likely to play without the benefit of an athletic scholarship. The point here is simply that prong three allows you the flexibility to make these types of financial decisions if you wish to make them in a down economic market. Certainly not something that you have to do, but it's something that you have the flexibility to potentially do if you wish to. But let's look at the flip side of that, some of the negatives associated with prong two or prong three. As we talked about before, there's a drawback with prong two or prong three compliance because it's not public. Right, you're still going to have the plaintiff's attorney or the OCR investigator looking at your EADA report and assuming that your school is not in compliance at all with Title IX based simply on your prong one numbers. So what can you do? To decrease your exposure, you can go ahead and use those EADA reports to your benefit. Underneath where you put your prong one participation numbers, you can give a brief narrative in the caveat or the supplemental information section to explain your proactive efforts at compliance under prong two or prong three. You can explain if you recently added a women's team. You can give a brief narrative about how you're proactively monitoring your students' athletic interests or how you offer a diverse array of athletic opportunities, not only at the varsity level, but also at the club, IM, and recreational level. Of course, you must be confident that you do comply. You don't want to just assert, hey, we comply with prong three, because that might actually raise suspicion. Oh, yeah? Prove it. But really, this caveat area is something that might be of benefit to you. I don't know how many of you attended the NCAA convention's gender equity programming back in January. But a well-known and respected Title IX activist talked about how she does look at those EADA caveats, and she even singled out one school that she thought had a particularly good description in the caveat section. So use those to your benefit. To circle back to one other point, we talked before about those 121 California colleges that are subject to Title IX complaints. Well, what happened to them? Turns out that OCR actually rejected the mass complaints because those complaints did not contain individual allegations that each of the subject schools had violated prong three. There were only allegations based on the EADA numbers and nothing else. So OCR dismissed the complaints. The Title IX activists that were then forced to refile, and they did, for some of those schools, but they could only find prong three style allegations against about 10 of them. OCR took another turn at that, and they noted that even some of those prong three style allegations involving the elimination of women's teams were out of date. They weren't, the Title IX activists did not raise recent enough Title IX prong three problems for OCR to go forward with an investigation with respect to some schools. So that actually dovetails into one more practice point. Economics, as hopefully you know, is no excuse to cut a women's team under Title IX unless you are proportional afterwards. Not always, but generally speaking, 90-something percent of the time, the precedent is going to say that unless you comply with prong one after cutting a women's team, you are not permitted to cut a women's team. Why? Because philosophically, Title IX deals with the expansion of opportunities for the underrepresented gender and meeting their athletic interests. If you cut an existing women's team under prong two or prong three, you are not meeting the interests of female students who are on your campus now and are part of a viable team. You know, unfortunately, even in this day and age, almost 43 years after Title IX was enacted, I still hear athletic directors get caught up making misstatements, blaming Title IX when they have to cut on the men's side. Of course, Title IX does play a role when it comes to cutting men's programs, because as we just said, we can't cut on the women's side unless you're proportional afterwards. But the problem is that if that is overstated, it can lead to certain other assumptions. So I recently saw a school in the South that cut men's teams and said that they made the cut in order to move closer to compliance with prong one. Well, their movement was from something like minus 14 to minus 10. They're not compliant. They're not close to compliance. So really, they've done absolutely nothing to help their Title IX compliance by making the cuts. Perhaps they've helped their bottom line. They've helped themselves economically, which is a perfectly viable consideration, but it's not a Title IX consideration. You know, I think when a statement is made that you're moving towards compliance simply by cutting a men's team, what that actually does is it has the effect of increasing your exposure, because Title IX activists assume that you don't understand the way Title IX works. So be careful with the way that you express budgetary decisions in the media, and make sure that you properly formulate what role Title IX played in those decisions. So one final comment or practice point here in regard to the three-prong test, the importance of the attorney-client privilege. I mentioned getting your general counsel involved a few minutes ago. Your GC may be your biggest ally in this process because they'll understand about the institutional liability that you have, and hopefully they'll want to help. But more than that, you need an attorney, either in-house counsel or outside counsel, to actively help you through this process, since we're talking about how to comply with federal law, so that you can ensure your strategic planning and your other Title IX efforts are protected by the attorney-client privilege. So long, and just a moment about what the attorney-client privilege is. So long as you are seeking or receiving legal advice, the law recognizes a privilege. What that means, in practicality speaking, is that your strategic planning documents would be exempt from media requests. They would be exempt from production and litigation if you're ever sued. I've seen too many cases where a college hires a Title IX consultant who's not an attorney. That consultant prepares a report detailing all the things that the school is doing right, but also lists out, whatever, five things that the school is where the school has exposure under Title IX. Fast forward a year, budgetarily you've only been able to fix one of those five things, and then you get sued. What do you think the plaintiff's attorney's best friend is? What do you think exhibit number one is? Well, it's your own expert witness's report when they said that these are the four things that you were doing wrong, your four Title IX violations that you didn't bother to fix. Those reports can be extremely damning if they're not protected under an attorney-client privilege. So get out an outside attorney involved. Get your GC involved, but be very careful relying on a non-attorney consultant. Now, I'll also say I have a very good relationship with a number of non-attorney consultants. They can utilize the privilege if they are hired through the proper methodology. I certainly have hired non-attorney consultants as expert witnesses, both in the financial realm in order to help university athletic departments with economic feasibility studies. On occasion, especially as we're heading towards litigation, there may be a need to use a non-attorney consultant. But again, we need to structure that in the right way to make sure that their work product also is protected by the attorney-client privilege. All right. So I see that another question, actually a couple of questions have come in. I believe I've addressed them all as we've talked through these points. So, all right, let's move on to scholarships. The other major program area of Title IX involves the quality of scholarships. The standard here is that the total amount of scholarship aid available to men and women must be substantially proportionate to their overall participation rates. Again, total amount is the most important part of that phrase right now. This is an aggregated analysis. You look at all athletic aid that's been given to all female student athletes, and you look at all athletic aid that's been given to all male student athletes. This is a different analysis than the prong one proportionality, because a student can play multiple sports but can only receive one scholarship. So here we're looking at an unduplicated count of student athletes rather than the duplicated count under prong one. Another key difference as compared to prong one is there is no prong two, there is no prong three when it comes to scholarships, right? This is a different program area under the Title IX regulations. So you must comply with respect to substantial proportionality. So what does that mean? All right, we know that it's a little bit vague under prong one. Here, under scholarships, it's not vague. Since 1998, OCR has given us clear guidance that a school is required to fund scholarships in a ratio within 1% of its actual student participation ratio. So if 45% of your student athletes are female, then between 44 and 46% of your scholarship dollars must go to women. There is some flexibility under this aspect of Title IX. OCR will consider legitimate non-discriminatory reasons for scholarship disparities, but these categories tend to be narrow, and they don't tend to cover large gaps when it comes to scholarship funding. So before I give you the current Title IX compliance statistics, let me mention also, take a step back, let's talk philosophy a little bit about Title IX. So because women are usually the underrepresented gender in regard to participation opportunities, and because of the media attention, we usually think of Title IX, and frankly, Title IX is usually used as a pro-women sports law, and in this day and age, it's also a sexual harassment and sexual assault law as well. But at its core, Title IX is fundamentally an anti-discrimination law, which potentially can cut both ways. And that's important to remember. In regard to scholarships, as with other areas, Title IX requires that male and female athletes receive equivalent treatment when viewed in the aggregate. So what does that mean? Again, let's take a look at your own EADA self-reported publicly available compliance statistics. During the 2000, and this slide is a little bit different than before. It's not intended to add up to 100%. This instead just kind of depicts in a cascading way how far out of compliance schools are. During the 2013-2014 school year, only 12.5% of all NCAA schools that give athletic scholarships, which of course excludes Division III, only 12.5% of these schools self-reported that they were within the 1% requirement. What's interesting here, just from the standpoint of public perception, is that 64.2% of all NCAA schools are at plus 1% or farther. And again, remember, this is from the female student athlete's perspective. So women are underfunded if it's minus 1 or minus 5. men are actually the underfunded gender if it's plus 1 or plus 5 or plus 10. So if you look at that, the first red line under the green line, 64.2% of all NCAA Division I and Division II schools reported last year that men were the underfunded gender by more than 1%. Women are the underfunded gender at only 23.3% of all NCAA institutions, again, according to your own EADA reports. So nationally, across all NCAA schools that provide athletic scholarships, just to look in the aggregate across all schools, female student athletes receive only 42.9% of all athletic opportunities. And we certainly can take issue with that and assert that they should have more opportunities now, 43 years after Title IX has been enacted. But if we just recognize for a moment that the scholarship analysis is under a different program area of Title IX than the participation opportunities, we realize that those 42.9% of all student athletes are actually receiving 46.2% of all athletics aid nationwide, for a 3.3% overall scholarship disparity in favor of female student athletes. So for several years, this is one more slide just to show, generally speaking, those schools that are in the green zone that are safe being within 1% of proportionality, and then just showing visually how many schools have women as the underfunded gender and how many schools have men as the underfunded gender in regard to athletic scholarships according to schools' own Equity and Athletics Disclosure Act reports. All right, so moving on to enforcement trends. For several years, it was accepted that overfunding women's scholarships would be just fine. It would offset providing fewer participation opportunities for women. But that clearly is not the case anymore. OCR recently went after Butler University, the NCAA Cinderella, because women were underrepresented, but men were underfunded within the Butler Athletic Department. And at the end of the day, Butler was held to have been discriminating against both men and women at the same time under different Title IX provisions, thus affirming what we all learned in first grade, two wrongs don't make a right. You can simultaneously discriminate against both men and women at the same time under different provisions of Title IX. That by no means was an isolated case. At least one SEC school has just recently gone through the same thing with OCR. So while you may not be alone with these numbers, it's important for you to not take any comfort in them. You could be sued or investigated tomorrow for these types of disparities. Moving on to kind of risks and exposure, I want to return to this slide for just a moment. Who is most likely to be sued or investigated based on their scholarship disparities? Well, there certainly are a lot of schools with exposure on the scholarship side where men are the underfunded gender. I would say, based on my experience, that those schools with the biggest exposure are actually those on the top line, those 46 schools where women are underfunded by 5% or more. Back in the mid-90s, the National Women's Law Center did a campaign that they called the 25 for 25 campaign, where they specifically went after schools where women were underfunded by what they consider to be significant margins. And I worked on two of those cases at the time, and of course there have been continuing ramifications coming out of those cases for years and years afterwards. There's just a much stronger infrastructure among Title IX activists to protect female students and female student athletes. So while there are some male activist groups, there just aren't as many. So if you're looking especially at external exposure, you're going to be much more likely to get a complaint if you're one of those schools where women are underfunded as well as underrepresented. All right, so most of you may need to adjust your scholarship ratios, some by a lot, some by a little. But while you can throw money at the problem by increasing scholarships for men, that's rarely the preferred strategy, especially given the economic climate that we've all been under for the last several years. So there are four different levers that you can pull in order to affect your scholarship compliance. So obviously, there's funding. It goes without saying that for most of you where women are the underrepresented gender, you should not cut their scholarship funding in order to try to cure a scholarship disparity. That would just be asking to get sued. So instead of, and as I said, you probably don't have more money to throw at male student athletes. If you do, more power to you. So the other levers that you can pull in order to affect your scholarship ratios involve participation opportunities. If women are the underrepresented but overfunded gender, the easiest way to improve your compliance in both areas, prong one and scholarships, is to increase your female non-scholarship athletes or athletes who are receiving only partial scholarships. To take a step back philosophically, once again, that is also most consistent with the intent of Title IX, increasing participation opportunities for the historically underrepresented gender. On the flip side of that, you also have the option of reducing the number of non-scholarship male athletes. The effect would be to decrease men's participation ratio, but also stop diluting their scholarship funding. So by eliminating male walk-ons, you are increasing the relative funding for the remaining male athletes. And of course, conversely, women's participation ratio would increase and their relative funding would decrease if you are able to move your roster management in either of those directions. So, you know, I kind of didn't give a lot of credibility to prong one roster management strategies earlier on. This is where you need to devote your roster management strategies, securing your scholarship disparities, because there is no scholarship prong two, there is no scholarship prong three, whereas there is, those alternatives are available under the participation opportunities formulation. So this leads us into a discussion of full cost of attendance. I'll take a step back. When the NCAA and the Power Five conferences were first discussing providing full cost of attendance scholarships to student athletes, there were a number of different formulations that were potentially available and that were discussed. One of them was coming off of Judge Wilkin's opinion in the O'Bannon case last summer. Judge Wilkin held that revenue athletes, male athletes who play FBS football or Division I basketball, could receive full cost of attendance as compensation for use of their name, image, and likeness. So under that formulation, would Title IX apply? Would you be forced to give comparable, equitable amounts to female student athletes? Well, there certainly are arguments that Title IX would apply to that, but it wouldn't fall under this scholarship analysis that we're talking about. That would not be an athletics aid formulation. Rather, it would be compensation for an individual right possessed by a revenue athlete. It would be the use of, under that case, his name, image, or likeness. So if that was the way the NCAA and the Power Five conferences decided to implement full cost of attendance, would Title IX apply? Well, frankly, it's questionable. But that's not the world that we live in. Obviously, the O'Bannon decision is under appeal, and no NCAA institution is going to implement full cost of attendance and say that it is designated for compensation for use of name, image, or likeness, because to do so might undermine the O'Bannon appeal currently pending. So that's something that we can take off the table from a practical standpoint. Although in the future, if O'Bannon is upheld, or depending on where we find ourselves a few years down the line, that's something that, again, could be considered in the future. So the two more practical elements here for full cost of attendance was to structure the additional payments as either a stipend, where students would just get checks, or to tuck it into the scholarship formulation. If full cost of attendance was structured as a stipend, Title IX would apply to the extent that those stipends were considered athletics aid, and then schools would have to make it equitably available. So if you have an athletic department where 40% of your student athletes are female and 60% are male, then approximately 40% of your stipend dollars would have to go to female student athletes and approximately 60% to your male student athletes. But once again, that's not what happened. Instead, the Power Five conferences decided to vote to redefine a full grant and aid athletic scholarship. So the full cost of attendance addition is tucked into the usual scholarship formulation. It's the same formulation we were talking about before. there's plenty of precedent, and there is, we also have the policy interpretation from 1979 as well as OCR guidelines that stress the scholarship formulation is an aggregated analysis. It does not require a proportionate number of scholarships for men and women or that individual scholarships be given an equal dollar amount. It only requires that the total amount of scholarship aid that is distributed is substantially proportionate. And again, we've got a court case that affirms again that the actual number or dollar value of individual scholarships made available to men and women is not directly compared. So we've got federal precedent on this point. Since the Power Five conferences and the NCAA and others have followed this formulation of tucking the full cost of attendance addition into the definition of a full grant and aid athletic scholarship, that additional aid is treated just the same as any other aid. Nobody looks to see, oh, women are receiving more book money under their scholarships and men are receiving more room and board under their scholarships. That's just not the way the analysis is done. So from a full cost of attendance standpoint, could you give full cost of attendance benefits only to your football players? If you're one of those schools where men are the underfunded gender, theoretically you could. Legally speaking, you could. But we're not talking about a legal compliance strategy. We're talking about, I mean, that would be really myopic. Rather, this is a budgetary decision. This is a competitive decision. Given finite resources and a need to compete in the revenue sports, the way I would formulate it is, do you have the legal option of devoting your limited full cost of attendance resources to only certain sports? You know, if you are an up-and-coming SEC program and you don't have the budget of a University of Georgia or Alabama, can you do this? Or if you're a smaller private school that's dependent on tuition dollars, can you devote your limited resources only to those revenue sports? Legally speaking, the answer is yes. But let me pause here. What happens if the media calls you up and asks you, who are you giving your full cost of attendance scholarships to? And you say, only the football players. You know you're going to get killed in the media. I do not advise that you give full cost of attendance scholarships only to your revenue sports. The reason for this discussion is to illustrate to you the flexibility that you may have under Title IX. Schools really do have a lot of flexibility to implement strategies that fit on their campus. So if you came up instead with a formula, look, there are plenty of Power Five schools that can afford to give full cost of attendance to everybody. I think a lot of the Big Ten schools have come out publicly and said that's exactly what they're doing. But if you're not one of those schools, if you have more finite resources and you wish to give full cost of attendance scholarships, let's say to all football players, all men's and women's basketball players, all volleyball players, and all women's soccer players, and the end result is that more men are getting it than women, well, if you're one of those schools where men are the underfunded gender, frankly, you've helped yourself competitively and you've helped yourself legally through that formulation. And after this discussion, I think you're probably also going to be, if you receive one of those calls from the media, you're going to be savvy enough to explain, not directly answer the question of whether you're giving full cost of attendance to these five teams, but rather you would say that it's an aggregated analysis and that we carefully monitor our scholarship compliance and that we distribute full cost of attendance scholarships on an equitable basis, just as we distribute all of our other athletic scholarships on an equitable basis. So at this point, let me pause to see if there are more questions that have come in. I believe that for those questions that have come in over the course of the program, I've tried to work them in over the course of the discussion. All right, well, if no one else has questions, let me take just one moment here to mention the laundry list. Of course, remember there are 13 program areas overall for Title IX. 11 of them we have not talked about. These areas do tend to be heavily litigated. OCR analyzed their Title IX athletics complaints a number of years ago, about a decade ago, and they disclosed that more than half of all complaints they had received between 2002 and 2006 related to one of these laundry list areas. The single most common complaint OCR received related to disparities between baseball and softball facilities. But compliance with these areas tends to be subjective. So there's lots of potential for reasonable minds to differ, and it's not as conducive, frankly, to a webinar discussion because it's going to be highly dependent on the facts on your campus. So if you have any questions about laundry list compliance, feel free to contact me offline, and I'd be happy to give you some practice pointers. So let me see, another question has come in. So what type of time frame does OCR look at when evaluating whether schools are in compliance with the different parts? It really does depend. On an annual basis, OCR is going to look to see if you comply each year. Prong one is obviously an annual analysis. Prong two, prong three, OCR often will give a little bit of leeway if you can demonstrate that you're already being proactive, that you are building towards program expansion. If you're in a context of federal litigation, however, you don't have a negotiating partner that's quite the same as OCR. You may just be held by a federal judge to have violated Title IX in a given year. Another aspect of timeliness is at what point does a prong two or prong three violation expire? That's something that I think is really interesting. OCR has come out, at least their California office has come out recently, and implied that a prong three or prong two violation may expire in as little as 3 or 4 years, and it's going to be heavily factually dependent on what's happening on your campus. But if you were one of those schools that cut a women's team, you were not compliant with prong one afterwards, or perhaps you drifted away from prong one compliance in the intervening years, OCR might cut you some slack after the passage of a requisite amount of time. And again, there's not a strict formulation for it, but maybe after 3 or 4 years, OCR might begin to at least consider a defense that those types of alleged violations have expired. All right, so as we're nearing the end of the program here, let me take a moment just to give you some concluding points. Another question. No, I did address that one over the course. Okay, so if there are additional questions that come in late, I'd be happy to try to talk offline about it as well. So don't worry about it. I'm available to you afterwards. But let me give you a couple of concluding points here. I want to give you some confidence. Although OCR is increasing Title IX enforcement actions very visibly in the media with respect to sexual misconduct, but also under the athletic provisions, you know that each of you could be within OCR's reach. No school's immune. Every school has issues. But the key really is to take proactive steps to try to improve your compliance and to decrease your legal exposure. So the two action items that I want to leave you with, number one, recognize the scope of Title IX problems on your campus. Where is your biggest exposure? Where do you stand on your EADA report in regard to participation opportunities and scholarships? And then number two, come up with a plan to decrease your exposure. Where can you spend your limited money most efficiently? And then whatever this plan is, commit to follow it, because OCR wants to see not just a plan, but that level of proactivity, that you've committed to it, that you're following it, and they're more willing to give you the benefit of the doubt if you're on an upward trajectory. But again, come back to that important point. If you draft this plan it or draft it with outside counsel or with your general counsel's assistance, so that any sort of plan is protected by the attorney-client privilege. You don't want to leave yourself exposed with a plan that maybe you're not able to budgetarily follow through on over the next few years, and then you find yourself hung on your own document. So make sure to utilize that attorney-client privilege whenever you can. So with that, I will conclude today's webinar. I'm glad that you were able to join us for the webinar, and I hope that it was informative to you. Feel free to submit your questions via email afterwards, and I would be happy to have additional conversations with you. Thanks so much for your participation. Goodbye.